said, "Do you want a sandwich?"
Well, good afternoon, everyone. It's good to see a good turnout. I was thinking that folks probably want to hear what the dean does on her spare time when she's not leading the school. Well, it's a real pleasure to introduce Indy Burke as a scholar today and to hear about her research. Indy has a bachelor's degree in biology from Middlebury College. She has a PhD in botany from the University of Wyoming. She started her academic career at Colorado State in 1987 before she returned to the University of Wyoming to join its faculty in 2008. Indy is a world-respected and renowned ecosystem ecologist. Her work focuses on ecosystem structure and function in dryland ecosystems, especially carbon and nitrogen cycling, and the impacts of land management and climate change on these systems. Interesting to note that one of Indy's most cited works and most impactful work, if you ask her colleagues and her peers, was a paper that she published and led and published in 1987 that many ecologists say was really ahead of its time in terms of insight and impact on the field. And what that paper did was that it transformed our understanding of the patterns and causes of variations in soil carbon. So apparently up until that paper, folks were primarily just quantifying the amount of carbon in dryland systems, but not looking at the spatial variability of carbon in dryland systems. And that paper really changed the way folks started thinking about soil variability in these systems. The relevance of her work is evidenced by the range of agencies that has supported her work. Indy has received funding from National Science Foundation, NASA, EPA, and even the NIH. She's been on numerous scientific committees and boards, including the National Academy Committee on the Practice of Sustainability, the National Academy Committee on Scientific Tools and Approaches for Sustainability. She's also been a member of the EPA Scientific Advisory Board since 2010. She was elected as a fellow of the American Association for the Advancement of Science in 2010. And today her talk is on the Odyssey of Carbon and Nitrogen. So please join me in welcoming Indy Burke.
It is so great to finally get a chance to stand up here and talk about something I know something about and something that I'm really pretty passionate about. I care a great deal about dry lands and about biogeochemical cycling. And what I want to do today is hopefully get you to share or begin to appreciate why I might be so passionate. And I think the main message I can tell you at the outset that I want you to get is that it's not only carbon we should be concerned about in dryland ecosystems, it's also nitrogen and the relationship of nitrogen to carbon. Or as Mark Bradford said when I talked to him about this, he said, tell them they really have more to worry about than they thought. What I've had the chance to do while thinking about the talk is look back over the big picture, some of the work that I've done with postdocs, graduate students, and colleagues. And I have some new ideas about how to put that together into a synthesis and a new paper, so I'm also interested in getting feedback from you about how I'm thinking about things. So why would a person be interested in temperate drylands? This is a map of where the temperate drylands of the world are, and you may not know that drylands altogether, including the tropical drylands, cover about 40% of the terrestrial Earth's surface. They're inhabited by 30% of the world's population. They have 50% of the world's livestock. They produce 44% of the world's food and have 20% of the world's carbon. Of course, the temperate drylands are only about a half of all the drylands in the world, but I want to focus there today. The other thing is that they're particularly utilized for cropping. In that map that I showed you, you would have seen that these are some of the drylands. The other drylands are here, and in South America, here, and in Australia. And what you can see is that the primary color associated with those is red, which is cropland. So many of the native drylands of the world have been converted into croplands. They're heavily utilized for agriculture, and this is a big deal because agriculture can have a major impact on where the carbon is stored. And I'll talk more about that in a minute. But look at where the carbon is in these systems. There's only a little tiny bit of carbon above ground in a dry land. So when you walk out into a dry land, any forest people tend to think, wow, there's nothing here. But the forest is just upside down in a dry land. All the carbon is below ground. You can see the proportion of carbon below ground is much higher than above ground in terms of the root structures. And then there's quite a bit in soils. In this diagram, I show not only the amount of carbon in each of those pools, but the turnover time, and that is the average time that a carbon atom stays in that pool. And that's a really good indicator of how vulnerable the pool is and how fast it can recover once it's disturbed. So if you look at these turnover times, the above ground parts turn over about once a year, below ground parts about once every 7 years. And depending upon whether you're looking at recent soil material or the very old humic material, the soil turns over as short as once a year or as long as once every 1,000 years. And a rule of thumb is it takes about 3 turnover times for a pool to recover using natural dynamics. So we say, okay, if I disturb that soil, it could take as long as 3,000 years to recover. So this is sort of an indicator of not only how much carbon is stored, but how vulnerable these systems might be to losing carbon. As I said, drylands are heavily utilized. They're utilized for agriculture all over the world. This is a photo of grazing in Mongolia. Wheat fallow agriculture or dry agriculture. We'll talk a little bit about this. In dryland agriculture with a fallow rotation, there's only enough water to grow a crop once every 2 years. And for irrigated agriculture, this showing, of course, center pivot agriculture, which really dramatically changes the structure and function of ecosystems. So we have these pretty vulnerable systems because they have a slow rate of turnover. Some things change dry lands forever. For instance, urbanization. A lot of areas in dry lands are mined extensively for coal, minerals, and other things. I know that Mongolia right now is changing very rapidly, for instance, as a result of mining activities. And then finally, other kinds of oil, gas, and energy development. This is natural gas development from the air in Wyoming. You'd be surprised, wind development doesn't look that different. And I'll show you in a little bit the kind of surface damage and impact on carbon pools that some of this can have. So that's why we might worry about carbon. I'm going to talk a fair amount about nitrogen. And there's a wide recognition that nitrogen excess is a major problem globally. This is a consequence of the fact that nitrogen inputs into ecosystems are very, very slow through the biological process of nitrogen fixation. But humans have very much enhanced that rate of nitrogen capture through an industrial process by which we take nitrogen gas and turn it into available forms. We tend to over-fertilize systems worldwide so that plants aren't taking up all that nitrogen that's added, and much of it ends up in streams and lakes and oceans, leading to eutrophication. In addition, systems that have a lot of nitrogen in them produce a lot of nitrous oxide, which is a greenhouse gas. So we have lots of concerns about a world being awash with nitrogen. Drylands are no different. In lots of drylands, the major source of nitrogen deposition comes from energy combustion. So just cars driving down the street are producing nitrogen gases that go into the atmosphere, and then they're deposited across much of the land surface. The other thing about nitrogen is that it's lovely. All nutrients are lovely. So I'm going to read you some prose because I thought Mary Evelyn might be here. Aldo Leopold wrote about how beautiful nutrient cycling in drylands is. I'll read you just a part of his essay about this. He wrote, X had marked time in a ledge since the Paleozoic seas covered the land. Time, to an atom locked in a rock, does not pass. The break came when a root nosed down a crack and began prying and sucking. In the flash of a century, the rock decayed, and X was pulled out and up into the world of living things. He helped build a flower which fed a deer, which fed an Indian, all in a single year. From his birth in the Indian's bones, X joined again in chase and flight, feast and famine, hope and fear. He felt these things as changes in the little chemical pushes and pulls that tugged timelessly at every atom. When the Indian took his leave of the prairie, X moldered briefly underground, only to embark on a second trip through the bloodstream of the land. I know, now you're all going to want to be biogeochemists. So as I talk about carbon and nitrogen relationships in drylands, I want to tell you a little bit about the diversity of approaches that I've used with my students, colleagues, and postdocs in addressing carbon and nitrogen. And Karen referred to one of these. First, there's a set of empirical data analyses that we do. This paper that Karen referred to was an example of the first where we look across spatial gradients and make measurements and do some sort of analysis that allows us to tease out what the causes and relationships are for carbon and nitrogen dynamics across spatial gradients. We also do long-term monitoring. I was very lucky to be a part of the long-term ecological research program for a few decades, and I'll talk about work that's based on as much as 50 or 60 years of experimentation. We do long-term monitoring as well as manipulative experiments. We also do short-term field experiments and lab experiments. And then we do meta-analysis, that is collecting data, harvesting data from many different areas and putting them together and seeing what patterns emerge. As a result of doing that kind of work, we put together ideas about how the world might work. We call those ideas hypotheses. Then, in some cases, we take those ideas about hypotheses and we incorporate them into mathematical equations, sets of mathematical equations that we call simulation models. We make predictions with the simulation models, then we challenge those predictions against new data. And in the most interesting cases, the model fails and we learn that we were wrong. So then we have new questions that we can go out and explore. Oh, let me just say that this little approach button. I'm going to show quite a bit of data after my introduction here. And in the bottom corner of every data slide, it'll show what kind of approach we use to generate those data. So let me give you the roadmap, the interminable roadmap that you will see frequently throughout the talk. I want to give you just a little bit of background on carbon and nitrogen in dry land systems and provide a conceptual framework to think about how they interact together. Then I'll talk about indirect impacts of humans with respect to climate change, and then direct impacts, that is how it is that we go out and change the land and what the consequences are for carbon and nitrogen storage and cycling. I'll end by provoking you to think about how we might engage in some sort of mitigation practices to reverse some of these long-term impacts. So first, I have to do the carbon and nitrogen cycle, and I'm going to do it in such a way that I think I'll just introduce some terminology that we can carry through. Carbon enters ecosystems only one way, and that's through what we call net primary productivity, or that's the net effect of all photosynthesis in systems. So plants are the engine by which carbon dioxide is taken from the atmosphere and stored in ecosystems. For the purpose of this talk, I'm not going to talk much about the rest of the carbon cycle in the organic part of the ecosystem. I tend to think of carbon and nitrogen as just the way carbon-carbon bonds travel through ecosystems, and for this talk, we're just going to keep track of how much is in that box in organic form. Carbon leaves in only one way, and that's through respiration. That's what we're all doing right now. We're breaking carbon-carbon bonds and releasing carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. Critically, the inorganic form of carbon that's released from ecosystems is a gas, and it's always that way for carbon, and it's rarely that way for nitrogen. So here's nitrogen. So now I've taken all the organisms out of the ecosystem box. And I've just shown you the example of the way that we might think about ecosystem carbon and nitrogen, and that is that they're linked together. And I show here an amino acid but all of the molecules in our bodies have carbon linked to nitrogen, amino acids, which turn into proteins, and then we have enzymes, all of our RNA, all of our DNA. There's all nitrogen in there. So anything we have to build in terms of biomass, all the machinery of organisms, plants, animals, fungi, bacteria, requires that nitrogen be hooked to carbon. So it's traveling around the system with it. Nitrogen enters systems through a process called nitrogen fixation. We won't focus on that much today. Then during the process of respiration, when those carbon bonds are broken, CO2 goes off to the atmosphere, but nitrogen is released in inorganic forms through a process we call mineralization, and then it's taken back up again by plants or by microorganisms and incorporated back into those carbon-nitrogen bonds. If there's too much nitrogen lying around, you might call those sort of itinerant atoms, the way Leopold does in another part of his essay, it's released. There's too much there to be taken up by organisms, and so it's released. And one way it's released is through leaching. Excess nitrogen can leave systems through a soluble form, inorganic form. This can result in eutrophication, so there's sort of downstream issues associated with that that are very negative. Or it can be lost through gaseous forms, and I just want to point out one particular gaseous form, nitrous oxide, which is a very strong greenhouse gas. So every time carbon goes around the cycle, it leaves the whole ecosystem, but nitrogen almost never leaves the whole ecosystem. It's usually spinning around from inorganic to organic form, unless there's too much of it there. And that's pretty important because the two atoms work in a little bit different ways based upon their chemistry. So next, let me just talk about a few patterns with carbon and nitrogen, and then I'm going to build a framework that I'll use that we can apply to some data. This is a figure that shows the average amount of annual precipitation across a gradient that we used quite a bit in the central grasslands region of the United States. And you can see why this area makes such a great place to study carbon, because precipitation varies from about 300 millimeters to over 1,000 millimeters in a pretty much west to east direction as you get with distance out of the rain shadow of the Rockies. Temperature follows latitudinal gradients from Texas to Montana here, going from about 20 up to less than 5 degrees centigrade mean annual temperature. So what a great orthogonal gradient to study carbon. So this is the paper Karen referred to here. And I'll just focus you on the top. So we know now that precipitation increases in this direction, temperature increases in this direction, and you can see soil organic carbon increases from the southwest corner to the northeast corner. So you can infer that it's going up with precipitation and going down with temperature. If we look at some of the other data, this is a paper published by Osvaldo Sala, one of Bill's PhD students, showing the average precipitation versus plant production. This is the carbon input rate. You can see a really good relationship. So the explanation for why carbon increases going across that gradient is that there's more water. You can build more plants, the plants produce more litter, more carbon accumulates. But we also know that carbon decreases with mean annual temperature. These are some data going from Montana to Texas here, looking at mean annual temperature versus soil organic carbon. And you can see a decrease in carbon. That's because decomposition in the soils responds more to temperature than plants do. So the microbes burn off more carbon the warmer it gets. Now, if you're thinking about climate change, you're already getting worried, right? Because if you increase temperature, that means decomposition will increase and more carbon will be released to the atmosphere. Now, let me introduce a pattern with nitrogen. This now shows for the same gradient, total soil nitrogen across the gradient, and you notice there's no line, and that's because there's no relationship. So as carbon increases across the gradient, nitrogen does not increase concomitantly. We think about that in biogeochemistry as a carbon-nitrogen ratio. So here we have across a precipitation gradient, soil organic carbon increasing across that same gradient, above ground production increasing across that gradient, But the rate of nitrogen mineralization, or the rate at which nitrogen is made available to plants, doesn't increase across that gradient. So nitrogen's got slightly different controls in these are natural grasslands, okay? These are moderately grazed grasslands that are probably pretty similar to what they were under Bison. So we see as a result the carbon to nitrogen ratio decreasing across the gradient. Where there is the most carbon, the ratio is the highest, meaning there's less nitrogen per unit of carbon. Okay. So now let me build this. You're going to see this about seven times, and we're going to talk about where on this diagram you are if you impact a system as with human impacts. So here we have carbon balance. So the low level of carbon balance is places that are dry or hot, because there's not much plant production and there's high rates of decomposition. The high place is the place where it's wet or cold from low decomposition or high production. And here's the amount of nitrogen. If nitrogen kept up with carbon in the system, you would have a straight line. But what we know from looking at the native systems is that actually this line is curved. The C to N ratio alters so that there is less nitrogen per unit carbon at the richest places. And we could talk about why we think that happens, but right now I want you to take that as a given. This is what nature would look like before humans came along. Okay. Above this line, if you change system dynamics, you have essentially excess nitrogen. There's more nitrogen than you expect relative to a native system. And below the line, you have nitrogen limitation. That is, the plants might be accustomed to having more nitrogen in that system than they're getting. Okay, so I'm going to use some indicators to show you where a system is on here. Anytime carbon decreases, that means you're moving in this direction, right, along this axis, you might have excess nitrogen. You can tell that sometimes from increased respiration. You could tell by increasing nitrogen or its availability because you're moving up on this axis. And over here we would know because there would be an increase in carbon balance through increases in primary productivity, an increase in carbon, or there would be a decrease in nitrogen availability or inorganic forms of nitrogen. And we'll walk through this for a number of impacts that we have on systems. So first, let's talk a little bit about what I'm calling here indirect effects of humans on dry lands through climate change. We know about this from field experimentation primarily, but a little bit of spatial analysis. Dry lands are limited by water. Let me just start with that. So if you increase temperature, it conflates water availability with temperature, right? You increase the evaporative demand of the atmosphere when you raise its temperature. So temperature, thinking about a temperature effect alone is not really realistic. You actually also get a drought with that. This is a paper that Bill published and presented just a few months ago. This was his postdoc, Daniel Schlafer, in Nature Communications. And this figure shows, and I just want you to focus on the green line here, the simulated number of days, drought days, and the X shows right now how many drought days a dry land experiences in North America on average. The range here is the range of different models that are subjected to one of the global climate change scenarios. So this is North America. The rest of these lines are other continents. But what you can see is in surface soils, all the models essentially project an increase in the number of drought days. And in the lower layers, all the models show an increase in drought days. So we think that it's probably going to get drier. It doesn't mean there's less rain. It means that there's less water available in the soil, probably as a consequence of increased evaporation. So let's look first at the improbable scenario of there being more moisture available. Lots of the models do show an increase in precipitation, by the way. So we need to ask, what would happen if precipitation increased and there was more water that was available? This figure shows from a paper we published in Ecosystems, mean annual precipitation versus above-ground primary production. Clearly, we would increase carbon through increased production. This is above ground, this is below ground, and this is total. So if we go back to our diagram, this is sort of the simplest version here. What would happen if we were on this line and we increased water? We would encounter nitrogen limitation because production would increase, that is, the inputs of carbon into the system would go up. And eventually, through time, nitrogen fixation may catch up and the system could come back to equilibrium. This is the only case I'm going to show you that shows up below that line. That's a hint. Okay. What about a decrease in precipitation? I had a PhD student who started a study in about 1994, a rainout shelter before they became so popular, where we did this on low budget, by the way. He took garage door openers and attached them to a moisture sensor, and every time it sensed moisture, the garage doors would go over this big chunk of the prairie. We had a couple of replicates. And then when it stopped raining, it would go back, and we would send out the field techs, and they would add back moisture. And we had a control treatment where all the water that fell was added back in. We had a 50%, and we had a 0%. So let's look first at primary productivity. This is several of the years of the study. These are first 2 years that we're encountering the study. These last 2 years, we removed the shelter because we were actually interested in recovery from drought as well. This is the 25%, and this is the control. That's the 100%, so that's on the inside of the shelter where we put all the water back in. So just focus on the 25%, so you're getting a quarter as much moisture as you anticipated. You can see plant production went down. This isn't that much of a surprise. The top graph is above ground. The below graph is below ground net primary productivity or root production. So we're getting less carbon being put into systems as removing the source of water. We looked also at nitrogen availability. Here are the two major forms in soils, nitrate and ammonium. And nitrate is the most important in dry land systems. And look at how much nitrate availability goes up in response to drought. How does that work? Are the microbes getting more active? No. The plants are less active. They're producing less biomass. And so there aren't carbon molecules for the nitrogen to hook to. So they're lying there in the system in their inorganic form, vulnerable to leaching, vulnerable to nitrous oxide production, which in fact happened as well. So now we go back to our diagram and we say, okay, what's going on with the relationship between carbon and nitrogen? And what we see is a decrease in carbon balance as a result of decreased uptake. And then ultimately, we figure if you stayed in that situation for very long, you'd lose enough nitrogen because it's out there lying around to be leached or taken off in gaseous form. So again, we're above the line. We're in a system that has excess nitrogen. We've done some long-term experiments in the short grass steppe to ask about how water and nitrogen and temperature manipulations might influence a lot of ecosystem processes. We put in these little chambers. In fact, I think they're still there. They're called ITEX chambers to increase temperature. You can see we increase temperature actually by about 4 degrees centigrade during the summer. It's a lot easier to work in a dry land system and do this kind of experiment than it is in a forest. So I'll show you just some of the data. I'm going to focus just on the temperature effects instead of the complicated interactions in this. You can, as you might imagine, this analysis of variance, right? So here's nitrous oxide as an indicator of excess nitrogen. And this is the control. This is biweekly data here, but we collapsed that, summarized it into annual data, nitrous oxide flux leaving the system. Here's the control. And the biggest effect, in fact, was temperature. So we see an increase in inorganic nitrogen and nitrogen losses, and that indicates excess nitrogen. These are some of the other response variables that we measured. Here's the temperature effect. Carbon outputs via respiration went up. We'll skip that one for now. Nitrous oxide flux went up, and net primary production went down. So the combination of increased respiration and decreased production means carbon's going down, right? The N2O flux means nitrogen's leaving. So when you increase temperature, you find yourself over here also. Decrease in carbon, decrease in nitrogen, ultimately, and in this zone of excess nitrogen. I just want to tell you, we weren't thinking about this way when we did this experiment. So this is, it's fun to have a chance to talk about these with you. Next, let's look at direct effects of land use management, grazing, cultivation, energy, urbanization, and then some things that have to do with fertilization. Grazing has the least impact on these systems with respect to carbon and nitrogen balance, and it probably shouldn't be a surprise given that many of the drylands had native herbivores, not all, but many of the drylands had native herbivores that don't look all that different from the domestic herbivores that are out there. Let me just focus you on this here. We had an experiment that we looked at where there were grazing exclosures for 50 years. The Agriculture Research Service started these plots a long, long time ago. And we could compare grazed to ungrazed soils. And this is carbon, this is nitrogen. And you can see there's essentially no difference between the grazed and ungrazed systems with respect to carbon. Certainly, if you compare that, I'll just point out here, this is looking at a landscape scale gradient. So we at the same time said, well, what's the difference between the top of the slope and the bottom of the slope? You find that the natural variability just walking down the hill is higher than the variability that would be imposed by grazing animals. This shouldn't surprise you if we go back to our histogram, because the herbivores here are taking off this tiny, only a portion of that tiny little bit of carbon that's stored in the whole system. Grazing actually only has indirect effects on these other pools. So our work shows grazing really doesn't impact carbon and nitrogen very much. Now let's take on cultivation management. This is an aerial photograph in northeast Colorado, and you can see different patterns of wheat fallow agriculture, and you can see a little bit of native rangeland in here, and a little bit of irrigated agriculture. So in the case of cultivation, you go in, I mean, the reason we till is to reduce weeds during the fallow season. And the reason we fallow is to store soil water for next year. So we're growing a crop based on 2 years accumulation of, 1 year's accumulation and incoming rainfall. So that's why we do a fallow rotation. But it doesn't work if you have weeds there that are sucking the water out. Okay, so that's why we till. But when we till, we're breaking up aggregates. We're doing all kinds of things that really increase decomposition rates. The soil becomes lighter. And there's only plants on there putting carbon back into the soil half the time. So that's what I just said. And there's what wheat fallow agriculture looks like. I'll show you a photo in a second here that explains why we do that now. The wind, I can tell you, is coming from this direction. This is to increase surface roughness to decrease erosion. So here's what happened during early days of wheat fallow agriculture. This is a photo from the Dust Bowl. And I won't be talking about physical removal because it doesn't quite fit my context here of carbon to nitrogen relationships. But cultivation management can result in large-scale physical losses of organic matter. This is happening all over the world as desertification. We did an experiment using Bowen ratio towers for 3 years, that is looking at the total amount of carbon coming into a system and the total amount coming out. These systems are taking measurements at very, very short intervals, and we can add all that up and ask the question, well, how much carbon came and went from this system during a year. And I'll show you data from both wheat and from corn. This is a summary figure from several years through a season showing carbon coming or going. This is zero. This is a system that's not gaining or losing any carbon. If the number is negative, such as this good year for corn, the system's really taking in a lot of carbon, just sucking it in, pouring it into the biomass, capturing CO2 from the atmosphere, putting it in those carbon-carbon bonds. Corn varied between 2 years. These are the wheat years. The one on the top is a fallow year. So you can see net losses during two of those years for wheat and 1 year, tiny, tiny bits of capture. But this is what the balance would look like if biology was the only thing we cared about. So here are the data. This is the number I just showed you. We call that net ecosystem production. If that's a positive number, the system is taking in carbon. If it's negative, it's losing. But then you calculate, well, how much did humans take off of this place? I mean, the carbon's not just staying there. This wasn't on my carbon diagram. Humans are exporting carbon from the system. And you can see that for all of but 1 year there, all of these systems had negative carbon balances. So even in the best case scenario, cultivation management results in losses of carbon. It shows up if you just look at total soil carbon. We probably didn't need to look at every 20 seconds of CO2 coming and going. We could have just taken soil samples, and indeed we did. This is profile carbon in a native adjacent grassland, in irrigated corn and wheat, and you can see both systems lost carbon as a result of enhanced decomposition, decreased productivity for wheat, and export of carbon for humans taking the crop. Well, what about nitrogen? We did a meta-analysis that we published in Bioscience looking across all the county data for all the dry land systems in the United States that we could find, and we looked at the average amount of nitrogen added in wheat, in corn grown for grain, and corn grown for silage. That's when you use the above-ground biomass to feed to livestock, and soy. And you can see we don't fertilize soy much because soy is a nitrogen fixer. That's one of the reasons we rotate that into systems. And then in the green, we can estimate how much nitrogen was removed in the crop. And in all cases except for soy, there is less nitrogen removed than we added, which means there's extra nitrogen kicking around in the system. So back to our diagram. In the case of wheat fallow, we see rapid losses of carbon. This is up to 30% in 10 years from the historical data that we have. We assume that because nitrogen is being lost, this might ultimately come back into steady state. And in the case of fertilized systems, you're not only losing carbon to get over into this realm, but you're actually increasing the nitrogen balance because of added fertilizer. So again, we end up in the zone of excess nitrogen. I'm just going to show you a few slides here on energy development and urbanization, and then I want to talk about why we should care that everything is resulting in excess nitrogen. Energy development is a big deal all over the world, and particularly in dry lands. I'm going to intentionally show you what it looks like on the ground. There's sort of two big phases. One is the drilling rigs come in. And then the next is when the wellhead is there collecting the natural gas that's produced. So this is what it looks like during the drilling in today's world. And this is what the wellheads look like on the landscape. I gave a couple animals here for a couple of you who are not so interested in nitrogen. We decided to look at oil wells that had been abandoned quite a while ago. And the reason we did that is because in 1980, there started to be new regulations surrounding drilling of wells, which required site preparation, presumably for reclamation. And we wanted to see what the effect was without any reclamation or any site preparation according to standards. We started with the idea that probably those systems were less well handled, and that's not where we ended up, that the old way was probably worse than the new way. So this just shows, there's a database of every oil well that was out there. There's one that was abandoned in 1971. Here's one that was abandoned in 1924. And we looked at carbon and nitrogen and plant recovery across all of these. This is my PhD student who was a Mongolian Fulbright student, a paper in Ecosphere. And you can see here, let's just take on the northern site, the disturbed areas versus the adjacent undisturbed areas, there's no difference in carbon. This difference here is the carbon that is between shrubs and then under shrubs. So again, the spatial variability of the system overwhelms what the human impact was. And you can see this for any of the other, for nitrogen, and all the southern sites as well, that there's really no difference between disturbed and undisturbed. What's that about? There were drilling rigs there. I mean, surely drilling rigs or bad for the soil. Well, back in the old days when they did these things, if you look carefully, you can see this thing is on wheels. They wheeled these things in there. They didn't move any soil, and they just drilled a little hole and took care of business without trying to make things neat and organized. And today, here's what they do. So all the soil is scraped off. This is a process that oil and gas and windmills took over from coal mines. So the idea is when you do a coal mine, I mean, you have to move the soil, right? You're digging a big hole. But you actually don't for oil and gas development. But what we do now is we pile up soil on the side, topsoil piles on the side. This is not very different from cultivation management. And as the data are coming in, what we know is the new ways of handling soil for energy development result in pretty dramatic carbon losses. So here's our little idea. Back in the good old days, this is energy development with little site disturbance. And here we are with new energy development for the same reason as cultivation management. You're moving soil, you're breaking up the aggregates, decomposition is going up. And again, we're over here in the excess nitrogen realm. What about urbanization? I got very interested in this. Bill and I did a sabbatical at what was then the Institute of Ecosystem Studies, now the Cary Institute, which was starting a new big program in urbanization. So we went back home, and I got a postdoc, and we looked at the effects of urbanization in northeastern Colorado on nutrient cycling. This is one version of urbanization. Here's another one. We call these ranchettes. In the foreground, you can see a 150-year-old homestead, and in the background, what Cheyenne is doing to the neighborhood, sprawling out. There are analogous places, of course, in New England. Here's just one bit of data here. Let's focus on the nitrous oxide flux. This is urban systems. This is native. Here's cultivation management of corn, and here's wheat. And you can see the indications are that there's very high nitrous oxide loss. This is because what do we do in urban systems? We fertilize. We water and we fertilize, and it produces lots more available nitrogen. So we end up going in this direction with urbanization, at least rapidly increasing nitrogen balance, probably a little carbon increase because we're irrigating so much. So the summary of all this is here's, if we increase precipitation, I didn't show you CO2 results, but if we increase CO2, we probably move up some on the carbon balance. But everything else we do to ecosystems puts us over there in that excess nitrogen realm. Well, so what? Why should we care about nitrogen in a dry system? This is a photo from an experiment conducted in 1968, and in the foreground you can see lots of green, really leafy stuff. And in the background, you can see pretty much basic prairie that's not so tall and not so green and not so leafy. This experiment was started in 1968, and I think it was fertilized for 2, 3, 4 years. And the consequences still exist for the prairie. One thing is we get more primary productivity. If we look now at a review study by Laura Yajin in Argentina, you can see all the fertilization studies they could find in the literature in drylands, primary productivity in control versus fertilized plots, basically everywhere you increase production. So we do see a change in primary productivity in systems that are relatively dry. This is where we're seeing it. We see it in biosolid sites. There's a lot of areas in drylands that are being used for the disposition of sludge from sewage treatment plants. Here's nitrate in native areas, and here's nitrate in sludge-treated areas, more than 2 orders of magnitude higher. So we have a lot of places where there's excess nitrogen. So let me just remind you why that's a big deal. From a nitrogen point of view, one is that we can get leaching going into groundwater, influencing streams, lakes, the delta, and production of greenhouse gases. But there's other effects too, and I showed you those green leafy plants. We get a positive feedback with negative consequences in dry lands as a result of increased nitrogen. First, exotic species come in. Plants that are not accustomed to, are not well adapted for low resource environments are those that are fast growing and very well adapted for high resource environments. So we find in dryland systems a real competitive advantage for fast growing species that can take up that nitrogen and grow really fast. Those plants produce high nitrogen litter, because that's what they do, which decomposes into materials that have high nitrogen availability, which reinforces that. And in fact, if we look at the data from 1968 until many decades later, this is one of Bill's master's students here, we see here a long time later, 30 to 40 years later, exotic species density in the control, a nitrogen treatment, a water treatment, and a water plus nitrogen treatment. So, gosh, the weeds grow when you add nitrogen, even in a dry system. And most of these weeds don't provide very good forage quality for livestock, or at least not for most of the year. So we've been asking, well, what do we do? Can we stop this? I mean, nitrogen's coming down all over the world just from atmospheric deposition. What are we going to do? Can we tie this up? I got very interested in patterns in nitrogen retention across a spatial gradient. One of my PhD students and I, Jeb Barrett, conducted an experiment where we went across this gradient from Texas to Montana, and we added nitrogen 15. It's an isotope of nitrogen that we could trace. And then we went back and saw how much nitrogen stayed in the system 1 year, 2 years, and 3 years after we added it. And you can see that in the higher carbon systems, more nitrogen is retained. And what we think is happening is it's getting stuck in organic compounds and staying there, not coming out. In fact, some of the really old literature from the 40s suggests that really nasty old humus in the soils can capture nitrogen and put it into those heterocyclic compounds and store it forever. So that led me to do a little bit of a silly experiment. But here's what we find going from Texas to Montana on how much nitrogen can be captured in the organic matter in relatively recalcitrant forms, removing it from cycling. We conducted a biocide, that is, we added stuff to kill all the microbes, and we found that there was still some nitrogen that was taken up by those soils. We could look at the difference in terms of what biology was doing. So this nitrogen was being caught by microbes. Bacteria were growing. Fungi were growing. But something's happening here in the chemistry of this system to grab those nitrogen atoms, put them into tough carbon compounds where they don't come out. So is it possible to get out of this realm of excess nitrogen by adding carbon? Is this the way we can engineer systems to get back to the relatively native condition represented by this line? So we went back to those 1968 plots. They were really big and added a lot of compounds. We added sugar, which makes microbes grow fast, which makes them grab a lot of nitrogen. We added sawdust, which makes them grow more slowly, but they might stick around a while. So these really slow-growing, especially fungi. And then I got really interested in lignin, because I thought some of this non-biological stuff that happens, lignins filled with all these heterocyclic compounds, could result in non-biological capture of nitrogen that would go into those compounds and never come out. By the way, there's a lot of remediation done that's pretty close to this. It doesn't happen to be for nitrogen, but for toxic compounds. So there's one of our techs out there adding lignin, this really nasty stuff. You got to wear a mask. And the lignin didn't work. It was such a good idea, but it didn't work. So this shows all of these lines are the plots that in 1968 had both water and nitrogen added to them that had really high weeds. So we went in and added all this stuff, and we published a paper about how nitrogen changed and how much the weeds changed. And I just want to point out two things here. While we were doing the treatments, which is always before here, this was the control, the one that had a lot of nitrogen and water for many, many decades, and we couldn't reverse it. And this line here are the treatments where we added both sugar and sawdust. So, yes, we can do it, right? But then we said, how long will it last? We're out there adding 600 grams per meter squared of sugar once a month. I mean, this is like high intensity. We're definitely consuming more fossil fuel solving this problem than we were fixing a problem. So we stopped the treatments here, and it didn't take very long for even our best treatment to catch close to back up again. So the net of the story is carbon treatments are effective, but they really didn't last very long. Just in terms of why this might be important, Wyoming Game and Fish, who was here the other day, and the energy companies in Wyoming decided that the best way to make up mule deer habitat that was being lost by energy development was to add a lot of nitrogen. No experimental evidence that this would work, but the idea was, well, we've reduced habitat by drilling all this oil and gas around here. Why don't we make the remaining sagebrush that's there have more protein and grow faster? This was a really dumb idea. It was pretty bad. They stopped, by the way, and I it's possible we had something to do with that. We did an experiment. My postdoc, Meg Mobley, started this experiment. A PhD student who's here with me now, Chris Belts, is finishing this up. We added nitrogen. We also added carbon compounds. We're measuring stuff. We're measuring gases coming off and the length of leaders, which is the new growing parts of sagebrush. And I'll just give you a teaser here before I wrap up. This is inorganic nitrogen in the control that wasn't fertilized. Here's the fertilized plot. Here's the one where carbon was added. We added hay, actually, in this case. And you can see that we could mitigate the effects of nitrogen removal. And then we asked, this is leader length, that is, how much did individual stems grow in a year? This is what the managers cared about, versus how much nitrogen was on the system. And, you know, there's a line on there, and the p-value is significant, but, you know, that trend's not very great. The R-squared is 0.09, you know, so hardly any of the variance in plant production was explained by nitrogen availability. So we have bad consequences. We got lots of nitrogen running around. It's not being caught up in plants. I doubt that the mule deer are going to feel better about the energy development as a result of Wyoming fertilizing the rangelands. Okay, so here we are now. We've put together data from many people in 30 years of my career, and we know that almost everything we do to systems causes us to end up in a place where we have excess nitrogen because of a decrease in carbon or an increase in nitrogen or both. The question really on the table is, what are we going to do about that? This is actually happening all over the world. All those impacts are happening, climate change, land use, mineralization, mining, I mean, and urbanization. What are we going to do about it? So I don't know.
So I thought I would just sort of leave you with that. We don't really know how to free up nitrogen or what the potential biological or bioengineering solutions might be at such large scales that could last a long time. And I'll end for Mary Evelyn and John with another Leopold quote. An atom at large in the biota, this is nitrogen without its carbon, is too free to know freedom. An atom back in the sea has forgotten it. The only certain truth is that its creatures must suck hard, live fast, and die often, lest its losses exceed its gains. Thank you.
We have a couple minutes for questions before we have to get out of here. No Pete. I don't see Pete. Oh, good. Reed.
You know, if I gathered that in some of the situations you described, net primary productivity increased, does that mean that you're getting more soil organic carbon and therefore carbon sequestration? And is it offset by the release of N2O? N2O.
Good question. I couldn't get too much into the weeds about this. It may be that more carbon is growing, but there's still way more inorganic nitrogen available in those systems and way more weeds because of that positive feedback loop. So there's negative consequences even if the balance of carbon has gone up, there's other negative consequences. Yeah. Florencia.
Yes, thank you. I'm not sure my question is out of whack or something, but the difference is that you showed between, I'm very interested in how different agricultural crops may influence the carbon and nitrogen dynamics, and the differences in the carbon and nitrogen balance between wheat and corn could be that simply explained, corn being a C4 plant, more efficient at capturing carbon, and then wheat not being a C4 plant, or is there anything else about that?
Yeah, in these systems, the key difference here was irrigated versus non-irrigated.
Okay.
And in the non-irrigated systems, there's only enough precipitation to support a crop every other year. Okay. So I agree with you that there's C3, C4 differences, but I think those are tiny compared to the impact of irrigation and fertilization.
All right, thanks.
Yeah.
Forgive my ignorance. I'm sorry.
Bad. Oh, sorry. Good.
About what happens to nitrogen during burning, and could suppression of fire regimes be leading to excess nitrogen?
Most of the drylands don't have enough above ground biomass to carry a fire. And while fire might have been important, remember that diagram where plants were just a tiny little part at the top? The fires are only taking out that little bit of nitrogen. Fires are pretty important in the tallgrass prairie, which is an example of the wettest kinds of dry lands of the world. And in that case, it has to do with litter dynamics. But there's no evidence that fires have a major impact on carbon because that above ground biomass is so tiny compared to the rest. Then we had Chad, I think, too.
Thank you very much. Have you noticed with the increase in nitrogen, that would be a change in your carbon-nitrogen ratio, that you get greater decomposition of organic matter from bogs to below ground organic matter?
Yes, when the C:N ratio goes down, decomposition rates go up, which perpetuate that because the carbon's going down even more.
But do you have evidence of that occurring anywhere?
Yes, we have litter decomposition data from that experiment I showed where we added water, nitrogen, et cetera. We had buried litter bags in that experiment.
No, what I was wondering about is in nature, in the natural world, with, quote, natural world without this, for example, have you ever gone to bogs or anything and noticed some type of either decomposition or lack of accumulation of organic matter? Have we changed the whole ecosystem that much?
It's, you know, that's, how can we tell?
Okay. In other words, nobody's been able to look at that yet.
Yeah, no.
Thank you.
Yeah. Gordon. Shout it out, Gordon.
This is off the topic a little bit, but I believe some of the areas you're studying are where wind development is taking place.
Yes.
And I'm wondering if you could tell us at all whether you believe or you have evidence that there's any ecological effects due to wind farms, say.
Sure. And actually, I served on a National Academy committee that looked at this as well. You know, this is wind energy is a perfect example of a topic you could use in a class where you wanted to totally confuse the students, because the local impacts can be pretty severe, but the global impacts can really be important as well by reducing fossil fuel combustion. They do the same thing with these wind farms as they do with oil and gas. They scrape the topsoil, they pile it up. So in terms of this soil dynamics I was talking about, there's large effects there. There's huge infrastructure, so there's lots of roads that go in and out of all these places. I don't know if you noticed from that aerial photo, this is just filled with roads, not only paths, but also lots of roads. So there's tremendous damage there. There's changes to wildlife in a couple of ways. It doesn't actually look as though the deer, pronghorn, elk care that much about the big wind turbines. It turns out sage grouse do, and they're a species of concern. And a lot of other species get whacked. The raptors in particular get whacked. Bats get whacked. There's no free lunch. Enough? Thanks, everybody. Thank you.